Okay, hello everyone. This is Saranya from English Department of Ayanarajanakyamal College. Today I'm very happy that we have such an eminent personality here, Dr. V. Sushma V. Murthy from Christ University, Bangalore. You know, she is very well known for her simplicity, and she is specialist in both language and literature. So I'm very happy to welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Welcome to ANJAC, ma'am. Your first question: why do the students from rural background fear of learning English language, and how can they rectify it? How can they overcome that?
Okay, so to begin with, English is a foreign language to Indians. So there is that influence of mother tongue also from childhood. So you can say that we are in a post-colonial world. And we have this burden of colonization which has come to us through history. And most of the colonization that happened through language.
Yeah.
And as a result of which, now we have English education as the main right mode of education. So no matter how much you get trained in English, English is still a foreign language.
Yes.
So I would say that learning a foreign language is not easy, but it's not impossible. Actually, if you look at the English proficiency tests that are carried out abroad, Indians always get the top scores.
Yes.
Okay, and it is believed that Indians speak the most grammatically correct language in English most of the time.
Yes.
They give a lot of importance to grammar.
Of course.
So, but when it comes to rural areas, what happens is the primary school foundation in English is not very strong, because most of them would have studied in government colleges or colleges where Tamil or Kannada or one of the languages would have been the medium of instruction. So I feel that students need to gain more exposure to the language in terms of speaking itself.
Okay.
So they should speak more. That's the only way you gain proficiency in a language. Just reading will not help.
Okay.
And another thing is, I don't think students read as many books as they used to now.
Yes,
because you have so many other forms of entertainment, right? So
correct.
Book reading has taken a back burner, it's on the back burner, it has taken a back seat. So I think we need to encourage students to do other forms of reading. For example, newspaper reading would be very useful.
Okay.
It's important for students also to read what they like, right? Instead of reading literature, they might find it extremely hard. So let them read, say, science fiction or mythology or fantasy fiction.
Yes,
encourage students to watch a lot of channels on television, which it could be a daily soap opera, or it could be a comic series, it could be something like what do you call these very popular shows these days, right?
Reality shows.
So for example, Game of Thrones is very popular.
Yes.
Among students. Although they
obviously
may not have read the book,
yeah,
they watch the series. So I think it's important for any learner of the English language to have constant exposure to the language.
Okay.
I think that is very important. Apart from what we do in class, they need to maintain that connect with the language consistently.
Okay, very fine answer, ma'am. Definitely students will follow this. Thank you, ma'am. And the second question will be, what are the tools that we can use to make the language class very interesting?
Okay. See, the first thing is language classes need to be interactive.
Yes.
So gone are those days when you would just take a Renan Martin or a grammar book to class.
Yes.
And you would, like mathematics, give them some problems to solve on the board.
Yes.
Okay.
Ma'am.
So those kind of methods do not work anymore, because we belong to now a generation which is keyed into information technology at a very young age.
Yes,
so students, I think, for instance, like gaming, they play a lot of games online or
yes,
on their
ma'am.
Phones. So in fact, there are a lot of language apps now that a lot of, not just companies, but educational institutions are creating.
Yes.
For instance, in Christ University, we have introduced a listening app.
Okay.
For all the first year students.
Okay, ma'am.
So they have listening skills as one of the component, and what they do is they download the app on their phones.
Okay, ma'am.
And they use the app to learn listening skills.
Okay, fine.
So I think it's important to bring in an interface between technology and classroom learning, definitely. Have language games, make it a very interactive, process.
Yeah.
Rather than teaching, language cannot be taught. Language should be learned.
Yes.
And language
very
can be learned only through interaction. Yeah.
Exactly. Thank you, ma'am. And your third question would be, do we have to really compel students to talk only in English to learn a language, or how can we make them speak?
Okay. See, I don't think compulsion is good for anything at all.
Okay.
Not just language learning. See, on the one hand, they need to use English, at least in the English class. Otherwise, you know, it becomes difficult.
Yeah.
So I would not use the word compulsion. Motivate the students to use English, you know, more consistently in the English classroom and outside, definitely.
Okay.
I don't think any language should be forced down somebody's throat. There is also an approach where you can use, you know, your own mother tongue to learn English, right? For example, you know, it helps to understand a language through its culture, for example.
Okay.
So what happens is when there is a distance between the text that you are learning as information or knowledge or just as a text and the culture to which it belongs.
Okay.
Right? That is when you don't show interest in a text. See, if you give me a Japanese text and I'm a new learner of the Japanese language, if you give me some aspect of where the text comes from, what the text deals with, what aspects of Japanese culture, of life, of literature, of living get reflected in that text, then you're, you know, going to help me to understand the text from a cultural perspective.
Okay.
And I think that's very important, especially if you're teaching language through texts.
Okay.
For example, I was a student of French.
Okay.
French was my second language in, you know, at college.
Okay.
And I was a new learner. And I was in a class where people had already done 2 years of French.
Okay.
At the PU level, 11th and 12th.
Okay.
I had done Sanskrit and I was suddenly doing French. And I remember I had a textbook which talked about extensively about French habits, their culture, their festivals.
Mm.
Say, for example, there was a text on the Eiffel Tower. And
okay.
much later, we had texts from very important writers like, you know, Rousseau, right? Or Molière. We had extracts from, say, Madame Bovary, which is a very important, you know, text, a novel of realism. So as a literature student who was doing literature, English literature already, I could make connections with French literature.
Okay.
And it was through literature that I learned French language.
Okay.
So it's important to make those connections.
Yes, indeed.
If you are just going to teach a language saying this is functional and you need to learn it because you have to use it, that will not help. You have to create a context for the learner to relate to the language, because every language comes from a specific culture.
Okay.
Right? Great. And the closer you go to a culture, the easier it is for you to learn the language, is what I feel.
Okay, very fine answer, ma'am. Definitely students will follow this. Thank you, ma'am. And the second question will be, what are the tools that we can use to make the language class very interesting?
Okay. See, the first thing is language classes need to be interactive.
Yes.
So gone are those days when you would just take a Renan Martin or a grammar book to class and you would, like mathematics, give them some problems to solve on the board.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
So those kind of methods do not work anymore, because we belong to now a generation which is keyed into information technology at a very young age. So students, I think, for instance, like gaming, they play a lot of games online or on their phones. So in fact, there are a lot of language apps now that a lot of, you know, not just companies, but educational institutions are creating. For instance, in Christ University, we have introduced a listening app.
Okay.
For all the first year students.
Okay, ma'am.
So they have listening skills as one of the component, and what they do is they download the app on their phones.
Okay, ma'am.
And they use the app to learn listening skills.
Okay, fine.
So I think it's important to bring in an interface between technology and classroom learning, definitely. Have language games, make it a very interactive, you know, process.
Yeah.
Rather than teaching, language cannot be taught. Language should be learned.
Yes.
And language can be learned only through interaction. Yeah.
Exactly. Thank you, ma'am. And your third question would be, do we have to really compel students to talk only in English to learn a language, or how can we make them speak?
Okay. See, I don't think compulsion is good for anything at all.
Okay.
Not just language learning. See, on the one hand, they need to use English, at least in the English class.
Mm.
Otherwise, you know, it becomes difficult. So I would not use the word compulsion. Motivate the students to use English, you know, more consistently in the English classroom and outside, definitely. I don't think any language should be forced down somebody's throat. There is also an approach where you can use, you know, your own mother tongue to learn English, right? For example, you know, it helps to understand a language through its culture, for example. Okay. So what happens is when there is a distance between the text that you are learning as information or knowledge or just as a text and the culture to which it belongs.
Okay.
Right? That is when you don't show interest in a text. See, if you give me a Japanese text and I'm a new learner of the Japanese language, if you give me some aspect of where the text comes from, what the text deals with, what aspects of Japanese culture, of life, of literature, of living get reflected in that text, then you're, you know, going to help me to understand the text from a cultural perspective. And I think that's very important, especially if you're teaching language through texts. For example, I was a student of French. French was my second language in, you know, at college. And I was a new learner. And I was in a class where people had already done 2 years of French at the PU level, 11th and 12th. I had done Sanskrit and I was suddenly doing French. And I remember I had a textbook which talked about extensively about French habits, their culture, their festivals. Say, for example, there was a text on the Eiffel Tower. And much later, we had texts from very important writers like, you know, Rousseau, right, or Molière. We had extracts from, say, Madame Bovary, which is a very important, you know, text, a novel of realism. So as a literature student who was doing literature, English literature already, I could make connections with French literature. And it was through literature that I learned French language. So it's important to make those connections.
Yes, indeed.
If you are just going to teach a language saying this is functional and you need to learn it because you have to use it, that will not help. You have to create a context for the learner to relate to the language, because every language comes from a specific culture. And the closer you go to a culture, the easier it is for you to learn the language, is what I feel.
Okay, that was a very obvious answer, ma'am. Thank you.
Then your fourth question, ma'am. What would be the best exercise to enhance the language proficiency? Daily routine.
Okay, language proficiency among all kinds of students?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, I think I have partly answered this question. See, the only way in which you can enhance, I think, on a daily basis to learn a language is to use it.
Okay.
So, I mean, I need to, like I was giving you an example of how I learned French. But if you ask me to talk in French, I will not be able to do it very efficiently because... simply because I haven't used the language for many years. And once you stop speaking a language or using a language, you know, you lose proficiency in that language. That which is not true of your mother tongue, because you would have learned it at a very young age. Right? At a very impressionable age. And you use it regularly on a day-to-day basis at home. And I think that is what I was trying to tell you. There is a functional aspect of language. You learn a language because you need to learn it for various reasons. And unless you put a language to use, it does not serve its function. Yeah, that is very different from, say, your mother tongue, which does not have a functional aspect, but rather, you know, it is intrinsic to your understanding of the world itself.
Correct.
So unless you, like I said, unless you understand and use a language in terms of certain other larger questions of the world. Say, for example, if I'm using English, I need to find a context to keep using English. I'm not learning it just because I'm sitting in the class. So tomorrow I might use it in my workspace, right? Or I might become a teacher, I might use it. Or I might, say, get into a profession that requires me to translate whatever technology I'm using to users through simple language. So these contexts are very important. You know, because you don't learn a language merely because you want to learn it, but language is always used in a context. So I think it's important to, you know, understand the continuum of language. And to also, you know, be aware that language needs to be continuously used. Right. So on the one hand, it's functionality. And on the other hand, it's contextuality. Both need to be consistently maintained.
Very well answered, ma'am. And the final question, ma'am, what are all the job opportunities, ma'am, available apart from teaching, apart from doing some other work for literature and language students, ma'am?
Okay. The first thing that comes to my mind that a lot of students are doing today is they do a lot of technical writing.
Okay.
Some of them work in media houses.
Okay, ma'am.
So they might be, publishing something, or they might be writing content for websites.
Okay.
They might be creating knowledge sometimes for particular companies.
Okay.
So they create a database for the company. So there is a lot of scope in media for a student of literature or language specifically. But language, again, see, if you're going to learn English, at the college level, that is not going to enable you to take up something big, because it means that you need to acquire certain very focused skills. So you want to become a technical writer, then you need to undergo a course in technical writing, at least as you need to get trained before, and you need a basic proficiency in English, in writing.
Of course.
Yeah. So same thing with media. You need to be familiar with journalistic writing or with producing news or creating content. Or suppose you go into advertising.
Okay.
You need to learn ordinary terms. Mm. If you want to use language and literature beyond the realms of teaching.
Okay.
See, for instance, I study literature and I want to teach literature. That's pretty much straightforward path.
Okay.
In the sense that at the UG level, I take up literature, then PG English literature.
Okay.
Then I take up the necessary exams, or I do an MPhil or a PhD. Then I'm totally into literature.
Okay,
but if I want to do other things with my knowledge of literature, for example, say I want to look at media, or I want to look at publishing, or I want to look at advertising, it's also important that I'm familiar with these subjects as I'm doing literature. So a combination like journalism, English,
yes,
or media and English, or communication studies and English, these would be important. That is just an example. Okay, so which means that I need to have some kind of a foundation or background in these areas for me to specialize and take up professions that might help me to use my English or knowledge of literature or my understanding of humanity, basically, which is what literature is all about. Okay. Content writing, of course, you need to have good writing skills, good composition skills. To a large extent, a lot of I think today a lot of my students, at least MA in English students, and a lot of MA in English students from across the country, they are doing a lot of technical writing, content writing.
Okay.
Or they get into spaces where they write for media. These are some very important spaces where a literature student can, work. Also, there is this notion that, if you are into the artistic, for example, if you're interested in literature and performance arts, so tomorrow you can actually produce plays. You can write plays and you can produce them on stage.
Okay.
You can become an artist, you can become a performer. Yes. Or if you are really interested in art in terms of sculpture, right, painting,
yes,
you can become a curator.
Okay.
You can curate art. You can, because a lot of art curation happens online.
Okay.
So most of these, museums or art galleries, they have their own website.
Okay.
Where they actually undertake an archiving of their work. So they actually have an online database where they have information about the painter or the sculptor, and they discuss the work extensively, critically. This is where sometimes a literature student who's also interested in art can contribute. Similarly, music, right? Yes. There are some students who are interested in literature and music. So I see that if there is an interdisciplinary understanding of literature,
yes,
that will help you to go into domains beyond literature.
Okay. Really, your answers were satisfied, ma'am. Really, thank you for coming over here, and you spent your valuable time with us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.